Can you start with short presentation of yourself and of your slides and your topic?
Okay, well, I will try to use, I will try to do it without slides and use the slides as backup if necessary. So maybe it's good that you understand that I'm working for an R&D institute with headquarters here in Belgium, but working internationally. And I am the head of IP business there, so we are actually busy with all types of contracts, ranging from university contracts over governmental funded contracts up to industrial programs that we are running, and then more what I would call service contract or development contracts. And it's in this context that I would like to place where venturing actually appears in our scene. I myself am an engineer from origin in automation, and I got converted into a patent attorney over the years. And now I'm actually more busy with contracts than with patents in itself. So these things happen. So if you look at our history, so we are in semiconductor. And I must say the industry that we work with, which are companies like Qualcomm and a few other companies that I heard also here that are here present, there is a big concern there about use of IPRs, a big concern in NPEs, patent assertion entities, and this type of things. So it's good to have that image that our typical clients are pretty worried about that. So just take that as a sort of message. So what has happened over the years in our institute is the following. We have been active for many years in what I would call IMEC programs, which is in essence a non-exclusive way of working with lot of sharing of risks, of costs, and sharing obviously also of the IP. So I will not go into details on that, but it's a model we have been using for many years. And I must say the last, say, 8 years, I think we moved more into exclusive contracts with what I would call development contracts. And that's of course a challenge in itself, but we sort of pretty manage that because in essence we work still then for a company, for a client who's actually coming to for a very concrete deliverable, a very concrete product development. So you get exclusivities, but actually you give exclusivities on less because it's on something very particular. And you know where the company is heading at, and you can sort of estimate where the risk is. We have also been doing, obviously, spin-offs. Occasionally, some teams would like to enter into the business. And actually, what we are facing the last 2 or 3 years, so to speak, is starting development contracts, but not with classical companies that we understand, but development on demand contracts with IP companies. And that's much different, of course, because we do not understand them. We don't know what their real product is. So what happens there is, of course, we try to treat them as an ordinary company, and you end up, in essence, with very complex solutions, very complex contracts. But still, we find a solution. Somehow, these companies, these IP companies, they have a strong background strength. So they are a little bit liberal towards us. And we end up with solutions like back licensing, cross licensing, reciprocal licensing. So finally, we end up as a solution. And the IP asset in this type of deals is not that great because they sort of rely on their background. But now we go one step further. We're not longer working now with IP companies, but we create an IP company ourselves. That's not a classical spin-off situation. That's a situation where instead of spinning out, we create a company, we attract money, venture capital money, and for that company, we try to do development on demand contracts. That's, of course, yet another scene. Because now it's totally unclear what the product of that company will be. And it's not so easy to find a compromised solution because the IP is, of course, a very essential part of the asset of that company. So you can, it's difficult to talk about back-licensing. It's difficult to talk about cross-licensing because, of course, the people who invest want to make sure that at least the IP is there as part of the value creation. So what is the worry that we see? I told you in the beginning, our clients, the classical industry, are worried about NPEs or patent assertion entities. So my worry is, are we not creating ourselves now NPEs? And actually are disturbing a sort of the equilibrium with our classical partners. Because we cannot longer find this nice non-exclusive spot where we have been working in for many years. We cannot rely on understanding what the company is doing because we don't know, and actually the company doesn't know either. And somehow you're creating IP, and the purpose is to create IP. And as long as everything goes well, that's even not a problem, but you don't know where the IP will end up. This company might be bought, and you don't know who will buy it. So that's a worry. And you can ask, is that a dynamic that will go on? Because we are definitely shifting from this program mode over development on demands to our venturing, for sure. You can ask, why is that? Because apparently it's less easy to attract money for R&D earlier in the life cycle. That's a trend. That's a trend everyone is observing. And we have to be worried, I think, if this dynamics is strengthened, for instance, because of IP value in itself diminishing due to, for instance, standardization efforts, for instance. Now I'm going to your topic. You might see an effect that we are forced more to go into this type of models. So it's a bit worrying, in my opinion. On the other hand, I think the IP professionals have a very important role to play here. I think one of the key issues in, I think, the NPE story is the use or the misuse, as people would call it, of bad quality or low quality IP. I think if, as IP professional, if we do our best to keep the quality high, so that really the IP is real IP, so to speak, high quality patents, I think if we are diligent in execution of the contracts and make sure that the contracts are still clear and the assignment of rights is done properly, that at least we can avoid that we are attributing or bringing sort of bad quality IP into the market. So I think there is definitely for the IP professionals and sort of the code of conduct to operate, there is definitely a role there. On the other hand, we also have, I think, a duty as R&D community. We have to ask ourselves the question, why is it that we have to go in that direction? Could we not extract more IP value upfront? For instance, in the earlier parts of the life cycle, should we collaborate better between actors in the R&D scene, such that at least we can extract the money in a zone of the life cycle where it's less risky? Less risky in terms of the subject I just discussed. So these are a few of the observations I wanted to share with you. And I know it's a bit controversial topic, maybe, but at least I would love to hear some comments or questions.
Well, because we have after a lunch break and we are almost the last session, so to keep up the some kind of movement in the room, I would like to, and because the topic is so diverse and we have such a diverse speakers here. Do you have some questions with respect to Vincent's presentation? Do you have something in mind?
Hi, I'm Kumar, with the semiconductor industry, now in private practice. Aren't some of those problems actually not specific to yours? Because large semiconductor companies, for at least the time that I was in there, from 2006 until 2016, sold off big chunks of their patent portfolios to non-practicing entities. They're creating those kind of organizations themselves. Mm-hmm. Isn't that kind of... aren't you making your life a little bit more difficult than needed if you worry about it, if your clients are exactly doing what you're worried about?
Yeah, well, of course, I'm worried because my clients are worried, of course. And where do we hear that? Of course, we are active in the Semiconductor Association, where in typically in the IP working group, the companies are represented. And they're very worried, for instance, with the introduction of the Unitary Patent and Unitary Patent Court. They fear, at least in Europe, that also patent assertion entities will have a better playing ground than ever before. So we continuously hear that story in these type of circles. That's the place where, of course, we can feel a bit the heat. And maybe it's unjustified, I don't know that, but at least we hear that. On the other hand, we have tried to monetize part of our IP because we have to, of course, as R&D facility. We also we need the money, obviously, to invest and to make sure that we are at the front with our equipment and our technology. But you see, in pure IP monetization, well, except for some, we had some good deals, but honestly. Either you end up with what I would say defensive companies where that really buy IP from the market, and okay, you get a little bit of money for that, or you end up really with companies who want to be very aggressive in the market. And for us, it's very difficult to engage with that type of party. Of course, we don't know if we sell it to a defensive one that they will not further sell it off. I don't know that. There is a limit to what we can do, of course. But we did have to set a certain policy internally to say, look, we will not engage with those because that would really upset our industrial partners, and we don't want to do that. So I can only say I hear them saying that they fear that, so we have to be cautious. On the other hand, we do need the money, and if the finance world would like to invest in us via this venturing way, who am I to say we will not do that? Very difficult to say no then.
Are there some other questions?
Just got the evil eye, because he's kind of my boss. But your topic was IP and finance, good marriage or a disaster. So are they divorced yet, or how will it be a good marriage, and how will it be a disaster?
I think the good marriage will be if the company can do for what it was designed to really bring the product to the market, then there is no issue. It's a sort of spin-off without much background, because in a spin-off typically you have background and you will exclusively license that, you will transfer that. Here you have a sort of pre-spin-off, so to speak, and you develop together with the money actually of the venture capital world, you develop the product. If the company is able to put the product into the market, there's no issue. It's like a typical spin-off, no problem. It is when they are not able to do that. Then, what remains, and luckily for the VC, something remains, it's the IP. And the question is, where will that IP appear? Will it end up in hands of a classical company who buy the assets? That's not a worry. But if it ends up in the hands of a patent assertion entity, And it's not about one patent, but of tens or a hundred patents. Yeah? That might be really disturbing for the ecosystem. Yeah? And I think at that moment we have a disaster. Yeah? So we have to be very careful. There we can only rely on the one hand that hopefully the IP quality is good, so that we have at least not created sort of junk IP, that we avoid that. Yeah? And on the other hand, yeah, hope that our contracts are sufficiently solid, that we only brought in what is really necessary for the company. So we have to be a bit careful there. Yeah. So we hope it's a success. The disaster comes when the company is doing what it's not designed for.
So then we all hope for good marriages.
Of course.
Okay, I think this is the last question and then we move on.
Two questions, actually, but I think they are connected. Number one, you spoke a lot about, I guess, patent assertion entities or trolls. Have you really made bad experiences there that somebody picked up on one of your patents that you kind of lost sight of and then the industry came back to you, or is it just a feeling that you're having? That's question number one. Mm-hmm. And number two, how do you protect yourself then in this venture capital scenario? Do you have kind of a right of first refusal? Because, I mean, if they really come up with good technology, I mean, you may want to have it back and then really license it out or sell it out to somebody else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, today we have not experienced that someone is actually in an uncontrolled way got access to the IP. So fortunately not, but of course in the IP monetization effort we did, we have been very cautious not to approach certain parties and so on. So, and occasionally we do get questions from type of companies that we really don't want to work with. So it's a conscious choice not to engage with those. Yeah? Because we think our ecosystem is too important to disturb that. That's one thing. Yeah? I must say contractually, what you see if we work with IP companies doing development on demand, there you can come up with more complicated stuff like back licensing, rights of first refusal, all these type of things. I must say in the SPV venturing, as we call it, special purpose vehicle venturing, as I call it, that's not easy to do because the VC sees that as extra encumbrances you are putting on his IP asset. Yeah? I understand that. Honestly, I do understand that. So what I call complicated but compromising solutions do not really work for that context. Yeah? So the only thing we had to set up a process internally for that is to make sure that, yeah, we are sort of executing a contract for these companies, yeah? That at least the assignment of the IP is done in a proper way, and that we know what we are assigning. Is it really falling under the contract? What's the scope of that patent, and so on? So this is the discussion is shifting then from the contract toward the real execution, also on IP level. Yeah? And there you have to be cautious, for sure. Yeah, that's what we experience. Yeah.
Thank you.